I'm going to call to order the February 27, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board. The first item on our agenda are the minutes of two previous meetings dated December 20, 2005 and January 17, 2006. Let's take December 20, 2005 first. Are there any comments with respect to those minutes as drafted and revised? David?
I accept those as read.
Second.
Second. Okay, there's been a motion and it has been seconded. All those in favor? Okay, the motion carries. With respect to the January 17, 2006 meeting minutes, are there any comments or questions? Barbara?
I know that on page number two, the last sentence, she has also driven Mitchell Road 5 or 6 times. That should say Columbus.
Okay.
I've driven Mitchell Road hundreds of times. And there are a few grammatical corrections, which I will skip. And on page eight, Mr. Mitchell, towards the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up from the bottom, Mr. Mitchell stated they're allowed 46 units, however, only proposing 42. This proposal is in compliance with adopted comprehensive plan that should read open space. And up in the middle of that page, it says, Mr. Murray stated there would be pre-blast survey prior to existing homes. I think we meant blasting.
I'm sorry.
Or that sentence makes no sense.
There would be a pre-blast survey prior
to blasting new homes, for new homes.
Excuse me, Mrs. Schenkel. Blasting could also be to construct roads. So it was just a statement on blasting.
Well, then we should take out existing homes and leave blasting, period.
Well, I think the concern that was expressed, that's exactly what was said, because there's been concerns expressed by the neighbors that their homes would be damaged during the blasting for the new construction. And so what happens is there's a pre-blast survey.
Well, I understand, but the sentence that as written makes no sense, so maybe just blasting.
Yeah. But there would be a pre-blast survey
for homes existing homes
prior to blasting. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's just a technical one. It's not substantive.
And the other item, I believe there have been comments made by abutters that the project is inconsistent with the comprehensive plan because of the growth map and the rural areas map. And I believe Mr. Mitchell did say that the project is consistent with the adopted 1993 comprehensive plan.
That's fine. I'm wrong. And the only other one is, and I don't know whether it was Mr. Sherman or I, it says Mrs. Sherman asked the town engineer to be prepared with suggestions for the neighbors. I think I said that, but you may have said that.
Like, I believe
it either has to be Mr. Sherman or Mrs. Schenkel, one or the other. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions or comments on the minutes from last month's meeting? Given, including the suggested changes from Barbara then, do we have a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Motion to accept the minutes as within changes noted by Mrs. Schenkel.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor? Before us tonight are some additional items, including a letter from the town manager regarding the Lions Field dugouts, a letter from John Mitchell regarding Spurwink Woods, a letter from the town attorney regarding Spurwink Woods, a memorandum from the police chief regarding Spurwink Woods, a memorandum from the public works director regarding Spurwink Woods, a letter from P. Driscoll regarding Spurwink Woods, an additional letter from John Mitchell regarding Spurwink Woods, and a letter from the town manager regarding the Elizabeth Park drainage. We've also received via email today, and I believe it's email all the emails regarding Spurwink Woods all came today, which are also included as part of the record. If anybody has any questions as to whether their email made it into the record, you're certainly welcome to call the town planner during office hours to make sure. I know they did come to all of us via email today, and we also have them here tonight for our review. Normally, we would be reviewing some of our old business first, but we had a suggestion prior to tonight's meeting that we attend to some new business first because it may take a shorter period of time. I'm wondering if I could get a motion from a board member to take things out of order slightly, as indicated on the agenda. Okay.
Second.
Second. All those in favor? Okay. So on to new business. The first item is the Lions Field Dugout Shed site plan. The town is requesting an amended site plan and resource protection permit to construct two new dugouts and a storage shed adjacent to Lower Lions Field off of Ocean House Road, U24-1, Section 19-9, Site Plan Completeness and Public Hearing, Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Completeness and Public Hearing. Ask the applicant to bring us up to date on the project.
Thank you. My name is Steve Harding. I'm the town engineer. I also work for Ost Associates. I have with me today Dan Sullivan, who's representing the Little League Booster Group. Basically, the plan before you is a fairly straightforward request. Just to orient you on the plan, Route 77 would be out here. The brown shaded area is the gravel access road to the Little League fields. This is the skating area over here. We've got the older, lower field for the Little League group and the newer upper field up here that's been there for approximately 5 years. Down to the lower part of the drawing is the RP1 wetland area, and we have the 100-foot buffer restriction zone here and the 250-foot buffer restriction zone shown there. Basically, what we have done is, or requesting today, is the replacement of the existing dugouts, which are the cross-hatched areas here and here, with new 8-by-20-foot dugouts. Basically, these dugouts will be a concrete pad with a fenced-in enclosure with a wooden posts, columns, and roof, and asphalt shingles. There's a picture of a similar style dugout in your packet. And also, as part of the proposal, we're going to remove a shed, which is located somewhere in this area, to an area behind the backstop. That's an 8-by-10 shed that the Booster Group is buying from the Southern Maine Community College. And also making a few adjustments in the connections of the chain link fence to the backstop area. If you remember from the workshop, there were some concerns with the existing drainage out there. The existing dugouts are very wet. We went out and looked at those again. Those dugouts are depressed, actually, so that any rainwater or any mud that gets tracked into the dugouts remains there until it evaporates. One of the things we'll be doing is actually sloping the concrete floor of the new dugouts away from the field so that any surface water that enters in there has an opportunity to drain out of the dugouts. We'll also be lifting the dugouts slab elevation about 3 inches above the surrounding terrain so we don't get any runoff coming from the surrounding areas into the dugouts, which is a problem with the first base dugout, I believe. The Public Works Department has been consulted. They're going to add some under drains around the dugouts. There's also some existing drains on the first base foul line side of the field that drain to a ditch off to the foul line. The Public Works is going to reset those and adjust the elevations of those. They've risen up a bit. They're also going to clean out this ditch, which collects a lot of the surface runoff from the field, and make that flow a little bit better. So we think in doing that, we've addressed your concerns concerning the drainage issues. We are asking for some waivers of the resource protection and amended site plan approval. The topo, we've asked for a waiver of the topography of this. We're very minor changes to the site plan. We're also asking for a waiver of the written description of the entire parcel. This parcel is owned by the town and has been for quite some time, and was part of the original site plan. We're asking for a waiver of the high-intensity soil survey and stormwater calculations, again, basically the limited scope of the project. And we're also asking for a waiver on the site plans of the lot line dimensions and the areas within 200 feet of the site and all the physical features on the site. Again, this is an amendment to an existing site plan, and those issues were addressed in the original application. So if there's any questions, we'd certainly be pleased to try to answer those.
Thank you. The first issue for us to determine is completeness. Are there any questions or comments on that issue? Seeing none, is there a motion for the board to consider? Peter?
I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit and amended site plan approval to construct two new dugouts and a storage shed in the lower athletic field at Lions Field be deemed complete.
Motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Yeah, the motion carries. We have advertised a public hearing tonight. I'm just wondering from the board's perspective if they feel that we have enough information to move forward after the public hearing to consider an approval of this project, given the limited scope of what they're seeking here.
You took the words right out of my mouth. Given the limited scope, I think I would certainly recommend that.
Okay. Well, shall we then just move to a public hearing? Well, now I'm not anticipating a lot of participation tonight, but if you have any comments on this application, please feel free to step forward to the podium, introduce yourself, and would be happy to hear your comments. The public hearing on this application is now open.
Good evening. My name is Chris Bond, and I live at 213 Ocean House Road, which would be this parcel right here. And this is 77, you said, over here? There are two baseball diamonds, as was described earlier, one up here and one down here. During Little League season, there is a significant amount of traffic coming in and out of these two baseball diamonds, which is great. We think these are wonderful town resources and think that Cape Elizabeth has done a good job of making quality resources available to the youth of this town. I do believe that two concerns need to be addressed before you approve this plan. One is that on this road, as you come off 77, the road is so narrow that if cars are coming in or going out, there's only room for one lane, effectively. So, for example, at the end of a game, you can have cars backed up from 77 on Soldiers Field, Lions Field Road, going all the way back to this diamond. And when that's happening, if I'm coming down to get into my house, for example, my driveway accesses off of Lions Field Road, I have to sit on 77 waiting for this line of cars to clear out. I can't even get into my own driveway. Further, because of the topography, and I think it's more a concern because if the road was lifted up at all, water would drain into my garage, which I'm certainly not in favor of having happen, but something needs to be done because in the springtime and the rains, this whole area of the road is just one big small pond, and the cars go around it, so they end up going further over towards my property, and the cars that go through it just splash mud and tear up the grass. It's just a mess. And each year the macadam breaks up more and more, and it's just getting worse. So while I have no objection to the dugouts per se, they are creating a large volume of traffic, which is exacerbating other significant problems. Other vehicles who are not willing to wait for the vehicles to clear out just drive over my lawn. I've had one car run into property of mine sitting in my property. So it's a significant problem. We've talked to the town in years gone by and nothing happens. So I ask that before you approve additional improvements to the diamonds, which is a good thing to do, that the infrastructure that supports those diamonds gets equal attention and investment. Any questions or just that's it? Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak on this application? I'll now close the public hearing. Any further discussion amongst the board? Paul?
Mr. Chairman, Steve, is there an existing building on the facility, and is that staying? Is there an existing storage shed at lower?
Yeah, there's an existing storage shed right here.
Is that staying?
That's being removed, and we're going to replace that with a new storage shed directly behind the backstop.
Okay, yeah, I didn't see where it had said removed, I was just curious.
Yeah, that will be removed.
Okay, thank you.
David?
Steve, just explore this drainage a bit. Presently, there's a problem off of first base side, and without the topos, it's hard to visualize. I think I know where the water goes. It goes down behind home plate and makes its way down to the skating rink area, right? Is that the way?
Yeah, there's a drainage channel that comes down through here. The skating area is actually on this side. There's kind of a gravel parking area here. It's not very improved. It looks like the terrain around here is very flat, and one of the things we're going to do is elevate the new dugouts so that they sit above the surrounding terrain, and then put an under drain on this side going off into this drainage channel, and over here picking up the water behind the, coming down the slope behind the dugouts, and then fixing the drainage that's already in the field, the foul area of the field, and then draining that down to this ditch, which will go to this swale,
which goes
into the marsh.
So it goes behind the outfield.
Yeah, this area here, and this, it's very flat in through here, but.
So actually, the water from the first base drainage won't go to your right, it'll go to your left.
The first base drainage, yeah, there's a couple of small basins,
yep,
in the foul area that drains out this way and into this ditch, which goes this way. And then again, we'll put a new under drain system behind the dugout to try to pick up the flow coming down the slope.
Barbara.
Realizing that the problem that gentleman mentioned really has no effect, I don't believe, on what we're talking about, because I don't think it's going to increase, the new dugouts are going to increase the number of people going at all. It's just to protect the children better. Mm-hmm. But what, Maureen, what can be done perhaps to ameliorate the situation?
Well, I'm looking at the town engineer because he's my drainage expert. But this is not an easy fix, and my guess is it's not a really cheap fix, and it's something that probably the council would want to think about and discuss and perhaps find a way to budget for. Maybe not something that we should address tonight.
Okay, I just want the gentleman who brought this up to know that at least I don't think that these new dugouts are going to make the situation any worse for you. It's not going to make it any better either, and will improve the field, but remain concerned about what you're saying. Not that that helps, but I remain concerned.
I echo Barbara's comments. It's really beyond the scope of what we're reviewing tonight. This is an application to replace existing structures. I haven't heard anything to indicate that this would have any impact on traffic or the drainage issues that you raise, but we could certainly make a recommendation that the town council, or could we make a recommendation to the town council that they take up this issue? Okay, so why don't we go ahead and do that? But with respect to this application, are there any other questions or comments?
Dave,
sure.
Motion. Be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit and amended site plan approval to construct two new dugouts and a storage shed on the lower athletic field at Lions Field be approved.
Sir, motion has been made and seconded by Barbara. Any further discussion? All those in favor? The motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, the town planner has just reminded me that we did, you're all set, that we had discussed referring this to the town council. So do I have a motion with regard to that issue?
So moved that we notify the town council. They ought to look into it.
Okay. has been made to refer this to the town council for further inquiry and discussion, and it's been seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Well, we get to send an issue to the town council.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next item on the agenda under new business is the Avon Road Private Accessway Permit. Graham Pillsbury of the Early Bird Group is requesting a private accessway permit to construct a driveway for a lot located at 5 Avon Road. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 19-7-9 Private Accessways. At this point, I would ask the applicant or his representative to summarize the project for us.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Jim Fisher with Northeast Civil Solutions, and here this evening with Mr. Pillsbury representing the Early Bird Group. In the interest of brevity and quite briefly, we'd like to be able to just familiarize yourselves with the site. This is a vacant lot currently that is located in the Shore Acres area of Cape Elizabeth. Essentially, what we have is two depictions of a building site. One shows a conventional scenario that I'd like to outline here for you in just a moment, and the other shows the scenario which we would prefer to have relative to the private access waiver. In speaking with the planner and submitting this information, what I would like to show you very quickly is if a private access waiver, which as you are very probably aware, allows access to a site that might not otherwise have the required frontage if it were on a public right-of-way. There's a minimum requirement, 50 feet, et cetera, that would allow then a road or a private access way to go back to allow access literally to a house or whatever other building may be back on a lot that doesn't literally have the required minimum amount of frontage on a public right-of-way. In this case, these lots all predate zoning. These were actually created part of an original subdivision back in 1911, precursing to any zoning that was in this area. So we have and this is sort of a matter of semantics, but we have a building lot. It's not necessarily a buildable lot relative to today's standards, only in the fact that it does not have the required frontage that is now deemed necessary by the current zoning regulations. So if we were to have the private access way that were required in order to be able to actually put a house on this particular property, on this actual section of the lot, again, these are the parameters of the lot. This is a typical house that you might see here, and this is the actual private access way that would be required if we needed to put one in there. As you can see, with a little over 88 feet of frontage, the private access way itself takes up a huge portion of the lot. That notwithstanding is not the problem. The issue is, as far as character of the neighborhood is concerned and every other consideration for a residential neighborhood, is this something that we would actually want off of Avon Road, which is right down here, coming actually into the lot? Conversely, this would be the scenario that we would prefer to have. What this shows is a house that is oriented directly toward the road, as opposed to this one, which is literally cocked 90 degrees to the road with its garage section right up here. This is meant to show the width of the type of access way, but basically this would just be a simple driveway that's literally only 25 feet back from the edge of the right-of-way. From fire safety, police safety, what have you, you've got a proposed house that is very relatively close on the lot, could shift a little bit back and forth. Right up to Avon Road or the public access way, i.e. if there ever is a fire and an engine would need to get in Avon Road, they literally could park right here where they're going to go where they want to anyway, but typically they would be able to park literally right in front of the house or even in this portion of the driveway. In this particular section over here, we're actually creating, or we would have to create, a road. It would be the necessary subgrade materials. It would come all the way back well into the lot, immediately in front of the house. You'd literally have a roadway coming all the way back almost across the front of the face of the house, with the turnout literally coming into the garage. So essentially what we're looking at, just sort of from a common sense perspective, is the private access waiver that would allow a waiver from this turnout right here, again actually just coming in with a simple driveway, the 30-foot wide right-of-way itself, which is this whole section in here that would end up being built out with the road within it. So we would not have to have the 30-foot width. Again, it would just be the actual driveway itself. And then there's the follow-on of a maintenance agreement. In this case, if we got the waiver and there was just a driveway, yes, we could certainly show what a maintenance agreement would be for an individual driveway. In this case, there would have to be an agreement as to who's actually going to maintain the road. It would indeed be the private owner here, but if there's no roadway to actually maintain, there's really no purpose for an actual maintenance agreement. This would literally be just a private driveway. In conjunction with the site plan, I'd like to be able to just pass out to the board very quickly. These are photographs that show what the site looks like and identify the locus characteristics on these photographs. And this is a reasonable facsimile of the type of house under the scenario that we would like to have, which is this scenario here. It shows the type of house that we're dealing with. As you probably noted in your narrative, if we were to do a private accessway this way, there's quite a number of standards to which we would have to adhere that are different from the actual driveway itself. Some of the things that would take away from the character of the neighborhood if we did a more conventional scenario like this with the private accessway would be to need to build that roadway to the DOT subgrade material status so that we're going to be excavating rather deeply, again, for what really is only going to serve as a driveway. Not an issue in and of itself, except that during the course of those types of excavations, you'll see from these photographs that there are a fair number of trees that are in the area. We would propose to want to keep as many of those trees as possible and can do so with a small driveway of this caliber. It's got this lazy S curve here because we did just that. We positioned it relative to these groves of trees that we would like to preserve to the greatest extent possible. In a situation like this, the groves, the birches that you'll see in these photographs would all be taken out along with a couple of other larger trees. And as you're probably aware, the drip edge of any tree is generally that which you would want to preserve if the intent is to actually preserve the trees themselves. In this particular case, because of the width of this, you're actually coming out into the drip edges of other trees that you'll see by these photographs. The point there being is that it is conceivable that given the depth of excavation, we'd end up killing the root systems of those other trees as well, whereas a simple driveway of this caliber doesn't need to go that deep. It's literally just a driveway. So toward that end, we believe that maintaining the character of the neighborhood would justify us being able to ask for these waivers and allow the building to be able to go forward with a simple residential house on a residential lot. And I'd be happy to address any questions or comments that you might have.
Okay, thank you. The first order of business with respect to this application is for the board to determine completeness. Does anybody have any questions about that issue? I do note that the town engineer had made a recommendation regarding the placement of sewer and water lines, and I assume that that's something that could be included in your final submission?
Yes.
Okay.
So we actually have, you'll see on the plan, the larger plan that you have, the sewer line and the water line are actually located on Avon Road, and we have taken these public water and public sewer lines out to them. We can show those direct connections, absolutely.
Any other questions or comments on completeness? If not, is there a motion? Paul?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered, that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Graham Pillsbury of the Early Bird Group for a private accessway for a lot located at 5 Avon Road be deemed complete.
Paul has made a motion. Is there a second?
The motion.
It's been seconded by John. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Oh, Barbara.
Question. I'm not sure whether I should ask it now or wait till afterwards, but it might be relevant. An abutter wrote a letter, which we received, and I assume you people have received it too, about the changing in the property lines. Is that correct or incorrect? Where there was a deeding, I can read you, conjoined lots 14 and 15 for purposes of taxes and construction of accessory buildings. Garage on lot 15 straddled the property line until the land was conveyed. Was there conveyance?
There was a change, again, far prior to zoning, as far as we can tell, because there was no information about that afterwards.
Well, this is not a recent, this is before.
Oh, this doesn't actually have anything to do with this lot. This is the abutting lot right here. Uh-huh. There was an old line that actually bisected a garage that is existing. In fact, that house, as far as we know, existed well prior to.
I see the line.
Okay. That property line was changed decades ago.
Oh, okay, so this is nothing that's recent or...
No.
Anything that would have anything to do with this particular, because that would have changed, this is a non-conforming lot, it would have been...
Correct.
Non-conforming lot.
You're absolutely correct, and we went through all that with the codes officer as well, relative to the information from the original plan and then the plan subsequent to that. And that's why we have determined that's not an issue as far as this lot is concerned.
Maureen, does that sound correct to you?
That this is a buildable lot?
Yeah.
Yeah, the code, I mean, there's, the Kirsteins actually own three lots, and they sold all, they function as one large single-family home lot, but they are legally, under our ordinances and under the plan that was recorded in the registry, three separate lots.
Even though that property line had been changed after the fact? Okay, fine, thank you.
Any further discussion on the issue of completeness? We haven't yet voted on this motion, have we? Okay, all those in favor? Motion carries. We have received some public comments on this application. We have a letter in our material tonight from an abutter, dated today, I believe. It would seem that it would be appropriate to set this for a public hearing at the next meeting. What do other folks?
I would agree, and we've also had correspondence at previous meeting, and there were members of the community in attendance at the workshop, so I would concur with that.
Okay. Oh, what about the site walk?
Since we have two abutters that I know of, at least that have written, I say yes, we definitely need a site walk.
I agree with Barbara.
Okay, I'm seeing heads nodding.
I've already visited the site.
Okay, all right. Okay, so we need to determine a date for the site walk then. We usually do these first thing Saturday morning. Is any of the upcoming weekends particularly good for people?
I may or may not be.
But I'm sure...
We're waiting for it.
Okay, well, you'll have an, it's easily accessible, so you could go out even if you're not available for the site.
I could do it this Saturday.
What time are we thinking?
8 o'clock? I cannot do it this Saturday. I could do it the following Saturday, which would be...
Why don't you go ahead and I'll go out on my own? John, do you live in the area?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'll go out on my own and look at it.
Would two Saturdays, not this Saturday, but the week after work for...
I can't do it the 11th. I can do it this Saturday and the 18th, but I can't do it.
Well, with this Saturday work, I don't live far from there. I can easily go over and take a look. This Saturday? Does that work for you?
March 4th, Dave?
Yeah.
8 o'clock. Shouldn't take forever.
Is that okay with you, Jim?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So it's...
So a site walk this Saturday, March 4th at 8 a.m. And right, Barbara and I will not be there, but...
No, I can come this Saturday.
Oh, you can? Okay.
Yeah, I can't come this... Well, I don't think I can come this Saturday.
Okay, so you'll be there to...
I'll be there this...
To run things in my absence.
Yes, sir.
All right. Then do we have any further questions or comments on this application?
Could you just give us the address of the next door house? Oh, it's right below, it's Acacia Street. Do you know the address next door?
I don't actually know the addresses of the houses, but this is actually, as you're coming down, or as you're coming into Shore Acres, it's the first right. And this is actually the entirety of the property.
Okay, that's fine.
And the neighbor is 3 Avon Road? Okay.
Thank you.
So just park right in front of the lot beyond 3 Avon Road?
As you can see from the photographs, there's plenty of parking. There's no curb there. You can literally segue off the side of the road.
We have a motion then, David?
Motion, be it further ordered that the above application be tabled to the regular March 21, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second. We have a motion and it's been seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Carries, thank you.
Thank you very much.
All The next item on the agenda is the Elizabeth Park Drainage RP Permit Site Plan Amendment. The Town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting an amendment to a previously approved site plan and a resource protection permit to install new drainage pipes on the school property that extend to the Spurwink Marsh. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 19-9-6, Site Plan Amendments, and Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit. Ask you to introduce the project and summarize where we are.
Thank you very much. Basically, this project is part of a much larger project that the town's currently undergoing. It's the sewer rehabilitation plan that we're doing for the townwide sewer plan. There are three main areas that are underneath that scope. There's several projects that are going to ongo, excuse me, in the north, and then there is the Running Tide, Winding Way, Maysfield Terrace area in the south, and then there's the Elizabeth Park area in the Brentwood neighborhood here in the central part of town. As part of the Elizabeth Park drainage, and just to orient you on the plan, this is the lower corner of the Elizabeth Park neighborhood. This is the area of the high school. This is the lower soccer field that was recently constructed, or is under the, is being constructed, I guess is a better term, right now. And basically, when we went through the Elizabeth Park area, we found a very difficult situation to do with the existing drainage. We have an outfall that is shown here in the gray line that goes to the receiving Spurwink Marsh down here below, and that receives drainage from a large part of Farm Hill Road and some of the side streets off of it. And basically, when this pipe was put in, it was some time ago, and we've got a very mature growth of trees, and it's a very developed, tightly, densely developed neighborhood. And we also found that the town doesn't have an easement for this section of pipe that runs across the private property. Also, we found, as this is the area of the Town Center Trail, it's an elevated berm that also has the town's sewer system in it, a gravity sewer and a force main, is that the elevation here, the outfall, is actually higher than the catch basin that drains into it. So we've got a kind of a hydraulically challenged area there. In the area of the school, which you approved last year and was under construction, there is a large 36-inch diameter corrugated metal pipe that comes to a catch basin in this area. And then it drains through this gray area in a 30-inch pipe over to an existing structure, turns and goes through a 30-inch pipe to the receiving Spurwink Marsh. There's also a 12-inch drainage pipe that goes underneath the soccer field. And as part of the town project, there was a 24-inch culvert put in here. The area shown in red would be the new drainage as it comes down from Farm Hill across this Longfellow Road extension down here to a new structure. And what we propose to do is tie it into the existing catch basin here, or actually replace that, and use this existing outfall pipe that goes out into the marsh. We'd make some improvements, actually shorten the pipe by 10 feet here to make a plunge pool area there, so to reduce the velocity of the water as it goes into the Spurwink Marsh. We'd also come back here, block off this existing 30-inch pipe, and replace this existing 24-inch pipe with a 36-inch pipe, so that we can carry the flow down to this existing riprap apron area. Again, we'd make some changes here to introduce a plunge pool, a little bit better energy dissipation area for the drainage to come down through here. We also have a DEP permit that's pending with the Department of Environmental Protection to do a site amendment to the site location of development permit that was received for the school project. And we're before you tonight with a Resource Protection Act permit and an amended site plan. We're looking for a waiver on a couple of items. One is the written description of the entire parcel. In your packet, we've provided you with a property plan of the town-owned lands here in the town center, which includes the high school parcel or piece. We're asking for a waiver of the high-intensity soils mapping and the lot line dimensions and all the buildings and streets and et cetera that go on to that. And that's basically the project in a nutshell, and certainly would be willing to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. The first issue again for us to determine is completeness. Are there any questions or comments on that? David?
Steve, one quick question. The number six, your waiver on the description of high-intensity soils, would you give us a brief reason why you don't want to do that?
Basically, we're not doing anything that's, this area here has been all reworked as part of the school property project. They were storing loam out here during the season, and they've spread that out and reseeded it. We're not doing anything for a building or anything of significant construction other than putting the drainage pipes in, so we felt that was a reasonable request.
Any other questions? Do we have a motion? David?
Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit and amended site plan approval to install drainage in Elizabeth Park be deemed complete.
Motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? The motion carries. A public hearing has been advertised for this evening, and we should also talk about whether we want to proceed with a site walk. Why don't we deal with the public hearing first? If anybody would like to come forward and speak to this application, you're certainly welcome to do so. Seeing none, I will now close the public hearing. Maureen, have we received any comments from any of the abutters? What are board members' thoughts on whether we need a site walk? Or go ahead, Barbara.
Well, I think this is just an improvement to the town facilities, and I recommend that we move forward with it.
Okay. I would agree with that.
Okay. Are there any further questions then for the applicant concerning this application?
I just heard the question, but not the answer. Maureen, we haven't had anybody call or?
No.
Okay. I'm prepared to make a motion.
Sure.
For the board to consider that I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit and amended site plan approval to install drainage in Elizabeth Park be approved.
So, motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Old business is the Spurwink Woods Preliminary Subdivision Review and Resource Protection Permit. Spurwink Woods LLC is requesting preliminary subdivision review and a resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 42-unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Killdeer Road. The application includes 19 condominiums and 23 single-family home lots on 24.97 acres. Comments of the town engineer are attached to our memo. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 16-2-4 Subdivision Regulations and Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Regulations. At this point, I would ask the applicant to summarize the changes to the project.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates. And I represent Spurwink Woods, LLC. What I'd like to do this evening is to just to review items 1 through 7 of my letter dated February 3rd, 2006, which basically outlines the most current revisions to the plan or to update the board with the changes that have been made. And then I'm going to turn it over to Tom Gorrell of Gorrell Palmer, who will talk about item five in my letter, traffic, and then just back to me for some final comments. Number one, the plan revisions. Beginning with stormwater management, as you know and as requested by the board, we have revised our stormwater management plan to basically utilizing the existing vegetation for stormwater detention and water quality, and thus eliminating the three detention basins that we originally proposed. The second change, we added some evergreen buffer to the plants, and this was one of the comments made at the last planning board meeting. We added a series of evergreen trees along behind units 12, 11 and 12 along this property line here. Basically, we had to clear to the property line or pretty close to the property line, so we have supplemented that area with additional red pines. Access to level lip spreaders, that was a comment that was made at the last meeting. We met with Bob Malley to review a number of items, this being one. And basically, he has agreed that with the equipment that he's got, that he'll be able to access the level lip spreaders that we're proposing. There are two here, three here, and there's actually one now located in this area here. by way of the proposed trail system that we're proposing, as long as it's 6 feet wide, which it is, he'll be able to access the level lip spreaders. So we have modified the trail system in one location, and that being right here. We've added a lake of the trail system to provide so that he can have access to those three level lip spreaders. He also asked that we install granite curbing at the intersection of Chicory Way and Kildare Road, which we have. We also talked to Bob about the Franklin Circle dimensions. If you remember at the last planning board meeting, we presented to you the revision regarding the dimensions of Franklin Circle. We reviewed this with Bob, and he agreed that to reduce the amount of pavement in this area here, what he recommended is that once this Franklin Circle is roughed out in gravel, that his office be contacted prior to the installation of the base course of asphalt so that he can do a test drive with some of his equipment. And a note to that effect has been added to the plan on sheet 5. And with regard to open space, this is just to document what we presented at the last meeting, was that even though we have 10.5 acres of open space combined, this 3.3 acres of contiguous open space conforms to the ordinance with usable open space. Preservation of natural features. Basically, Spermick Woods subdivision has preserved the entire area of RP1 wetland, has preserved 94% of the RP2 wetland area, has preserved the stream located in the northerly portion of the property, has preserved prominent ledge outcrops and a significant amount of existing vegetation within the open space. It is true that we're going to have to cut some trees to develop this project, However, we feel that we have met the intent of Section 16-3-10 of the subdivision regulations pertaining to the preservation of natural features. Number five is traffic, and Tom will address that in just a couple minutes. Number six, blasting. In the previous submissions, we have submitted blasting specifications that will be included in the contract documents of this project. This paragraph that we've written is basically to supplement information that we've submitted in the past to provide the board with background and experience of L.P. Murray and Sons with regard to blasting. Essentially, they've been in business for 60 years. They've never had a claim against them with regard to blasting. I've just talked a lot about that they've been called upon to do some real delicate type work. For example, areas directly behind the Brighton Medical Center, they performed blasting there. And L.P. Murray and Sons will work very closely with the Cape Elizabeth Fire Chief, and we've included in this packet a memo from Chief McGoldrick regarding L.P. Murray's and Sons experience with blasting. Number seven, the amended subdivision plans. We have supplemented our application with amendments to two subdivision plans. The Mitchell Highlands Extension 2 subdivision plan, which is located here. This is a portion, a blow up of the section of the subdivision of Mitchell Highlands. And South Poland Estates is the second subdivision plan that we're amending. Essentially, what this is doing is it's removing what was lot 39 of the Mitchell Highlands subdivision. We're removing this lot and incorporating it into the Spearmint Woods subdivision, which is our lot 11, located here. We have removed two lots from the South Poland Estates subdivision, lots 36 and 37, and we are incorporating them into the Spearmint Woods subdivision, which is located right in this area here. And included in your packet are sure. Which one? Both of them.
The second one on the map.
Oh, on this.
Flat of the.
There are two triangular lots that were part of the South Portland Estates subdivision.
Oh, so they're right in there.
One is located this triangular piece here.
Okay.
And the other one is located right here.
Okay, so that upper portion came from another source then. That was not part of that.
Over here.
Yeah, that was not originally part of
that's correct. Okay. So these have been submitted to you as amendments to these two separate subdivisions. My final comment is included in a follow-up letter dated February 13th, which you should have in your packet, which addresses the access to to lots 2, 3, 4, 5, and 11. And we've included this letter and two exhibits, Exhibit A and Exhibit B. Exhibit A illustrates two common driveways, which will come off of the new portion of South Street. The first common drive will access lots 2 and 3, and the second common drive will access lots 4 and 5. The Exhibit B shows that the access will come off, the driveway access will come off of Chicory Way. And this will meet Section 19-7-2-D-3 of the Open Space Zoning Ordinance, which prohibits driveways coming off of existing public ways. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Tom to talk about traffic.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, my name's Tom Gorel. I'm with Gorel Palmer, and we were retained to complete the traffic impact study that's associated with this project. At the December 05 hearing, we went over the traffic impact study, and the board had several questions that they requested that we respond further to. The first one of those had to do with the likelihood and potential of cut-through traffic, particularly to the mall and Fort Williams areas. Obviously, this is this proposed project is intended to connect to the adjacent neighborhood, and that has a lot of benefits overall in terms of public safety, efficient routing of traffic, and a whole host of other things that the State Planning Office and many others recognize and therefore encourage this sort of interconnection to go on. The primary concern whenever you get into interconnectivity is the potential for cut-through traffic, which is always there and needs to be balanced, obviously, against other objectives. And that clearly is what the neighborhood certainly would be most concerned about. So what we tried to do, it is a difficult thing to quantify, as we said during the last meeting, but we have made every effort to do so, and that's what I want to present to you tonight, among other things. And we've tried to be very conservative in doing that analysis. The numbers that I'm going to present to you are primarily focused on the peak hour, which, as I explained the last meeting, that's primarily how traffic engineers do things. We look at the peak hour because the other hours are less, so it gives you a flavor for the peak condition, if you will. And we really, we broke it down into two areas. One is the mall route, and the other would be the Fort Williams route. If, just to orient you on this map up here, this is actually Columbus Road, here shown in yellow, and this is the proposed site. This is Spurwink Avenue through here. This is Sawyer. It turns in, obviously, to Cottage Road. This is Oakhurst Road, which runs between Mitchell Road, shown here, and Cottage Road. This is Route 77, or Ocean House Road. With the project located here, you can see in this area, you can see the potential neighborhoods, if you will, that would cut through or be eligible, if you will, to cut through. And we measured things really to a common point as people were trying to get to the mall, which really is the intersection of Sawyer and Ocean House Road. So if we took it from a point in this area, we have several routes you could go. One would be to go down Mitchell Road and to turn right down Ocean House Road and proceed to Sawyer. And then you could either go straight or turn left or whatever you wanted to do, but that was a kind of a common point in our analysis. The other route, obviously, in this area would be to go down Mitchell Road to Sawyer Street and then, again, down to Ocean House Road. So you begin to define, obviously, somebody over here isn't going to travel all the way back up here to get here. And by looking at the number of houses here, we can try to get a handle on how many might do that. Now, in doing this initial analysis, what we really have done is we've looked at it without too much traffic calming in mind, if you will. We just more or less looked at it on routing basis. And in my second agenda item, I will get to traffic calming measures, which we believe will address the potential for that cut-through traffic. So if we look, and I've oriented this graphic, it's very similar to that one. It just sort of slices through about like that. And it shows a couple of what we'll call catchment areas here, I guess, which really are up in this, something like this, on this map here. That's the area that potentially could draw, if you will, down through this development. So what we looked at the number of houses that were in that area, and that comes out to 328 homes or so.
Excuse me. When you say that area, can you just tell me some of the street names?
Sure. It's basically bounded by Woodland, Cottage, Mitchell at Woodland, and Belfield at Mitchell. That's 328 homes. Now, what we did was we went to the Council of Governments, and based on the Council of Governments information, 17% of the commuters to work from Cape Elizabeth commute to South Portland. And of that 17%, 60% of it commutes to the Main Mall area. So if we take 60% of that 17%, that's going to come out to roughly 10%. Now, taking 10% of the houses in that area being eligible for the cut-through, if you will, or likely potentially to go through, they had three different routes they could go, which on a travel time basis, we did do travel times. They're somewhat similar, frankly. There wasn't one that's way shorter than another one. So we just said, well, we'll divide them into thirds. And in doing that, if we take a third of 10%, I called it 4%. That results in 13 cars. Now, how I get the 13 is there's the 328 homes. And so if we have 4% of that, that comes out to 13, assuming that one home generates one car during a peak hour, which is, that's a well-known trip generation statistic, and that's how it does work. So that's what we got there, which was a total of 13 cars potentially cutting through that area. Then we turned our attention to Fort Williams. On the Fort Williams, you have the same sorts of alternatives to get over to Fort Williams, which is this area here, or other spots along here. Fort Williams obviously sees most of its traffic in the summertime, but there could be other traffic potentially going to places, so we just use that number. The cut through, you can see we have a very large area down here that we identified. We don't obviously think all those people would go through there, but we wanted to be pretty conservative in this, so we really identified a large area. This is Spurwink here, Sawyer's over here, and we go all the way down, really down to Fickett in this area down here. We found in that area, again, the travel times were somewhat equivalent. What we found was 851 homes in that area. Don't really have journey to work information for something like that. So what we thought was that we'd use the number of parking spaces that are available at Fort Williams. And we determined that to be about 276. So we rounded it to 300 because they can get squeezed in. Maybe they park on roads and such. Of that 300, then, the question is, how many Cape Elizabeth residents would be there at that time, that, or people that would cut through? Obviously, people that a fair amount of that traffic is made up of visitors that aren't even in the area. Based again on information from the U.S. Census and from GPCOG, we determined that about 8% of the population would be from the Cape Elizabeth, Portland, South Portland area, translated into about 24 trip ends based on those 300 and, I'm sorry, 851 homes. Now, the 24 trip ends, we've got two routes again that we felt they could go. You know, they certainly could go around this area or they could cut through. We basically assigned, just divided in half and did about 12 trip ends. Again, that seems pretty conservative way to do it for us. So,
before you take that down, the catchment area to the the northern, or I guess it is the eastern, the smaller catchment area. There was a question, I think, in one of the letters that asked, why is this catchment area smaller than that one? Is it because of they would take a different road if they were further down?
Right, it was just looking at how, and actually, we spent quite a while with this because we wanted to make sure we felt that we were fairly comfortable. We have somebody that has lived over here for quite a while that works in our office, and I wrote it quite a bit. It seemed to me that there was a breaking point here somewhere where people really aren't going to travel all the way up in here, down that section of Mitchell, all the way through this development and down Sawyer Road to do that. It's a very circuitous way to go. So we sort of did break it in that area, which made a lot of sense to us. We just wouldn't see somebody, going to that length, frankly. So what we ended up with, when we add all those numbers up, what actually does that mean? So we looked at a couple of things. We looked at the two-way traffic on Columbus Street, just east of Mitchell. So essentially, just as you turn on to Columbus Street. We also looked at the two-way traffic volumes on Stevenson, just east of Spurwink Avenue. So those are the two areas where it would be the heaviest, if you will, where we've collected all the traffic. We looked at them for the PM peak hour, which is the biggest, largest peak hour, as well as daily. The pre-development volume, the volume that's there today, is 46 trip ends, or 46 trips. Those are two-way trips. If you just put a cord across the road, you get 46 people crossing it one way or the other. That amounts to 460 daily trip ends. Again, that's on Columbus, east of Mitchell. The traffic from the project that we went through the last time during the PM peak hour, which includes the assignment of some of that traffic up through Columbus Road, would be 8, which comes out to 80. Roughly, the daily traffic generally is about 10 times your peak hour. And so the total traffic from the traffic impact study was 54 during the PM peak hour and 540 daily. Now, the question had come up about cut through. We don't think there'll be a lot of cut through, but again, this kind of analysis is based on really not having any traffic calming, if you will, along the subdivision roadway. So we're just sort of kind of taking the worst case, in our opinion. Now, the additional traffic due to the cut through from the main mall that we went over, remember we said that was 13 trip ends during the peak hour, or 130 daily. The additional traffic due to the cut through to Fort Williams is 12, so 120. Now, in addition, we are going to have some internal trips, if you will, between the neighborhoods. Some of the Columbus Street neighborhood certainly will now be able to go down to use Spurwink, which is potentially a good thing because it's a more direct route for them. And vice versa. Now, we already had the vice versa, if you will, in our traffic study. There are 47 homes in the Columbus, Thrasher, Kildare neighborhoods. We've assumed that about 40 of those, 40% of those, or 18 trip ends, would actually go through to Spurwink, which reduces traffic a little bit at Columbus. So there's the 18. So we subtract those, that's 180 a day. They're now going down through the proposed project to Spurwink. And then we also have the existing Stevenson, South Hamlin neighborhood, which we assign some of the traffic back up through, obviously. That's why you're interconnecting these, one of the reasons. And that amounts to 5 or 50 for a day. Now, when you add all the pluses and minuses up, what we end up with for two-way traffic volumes on Columbus, east of Mitchell, on a daily basis, is 66 trips. That's two-way trips. Or 660 on a daily basis. That's an addition of 12 during the peak hour from the traffic impact study, or 120 daily. Going through a similar analysis down at Stevenson, east of Spurwink, the pre-development volume today is 25 trips in the PM peak hour and 250 during the day. The traffic from the project, as we indicated before, is 43 during the peak hour and 430 during the day. So you combine those and you get 68 peak hour trip ends during the peak hour, as I said, 680 during the day. When you add the two volumes for potential cut through and then subtract going through these numbers, you end up with two-way volumes on Columbus east of Mitchell of about 106 during the PM peak hour, or a little over 1,000 during the day, 1,006. The net change from the traffic study for that cut through would be 38 and 380, respectively.
Excuse me?
No, yes.
Can we get a copy of that?
Sure.
I don't think it was in your package.
Okay.
I can't read it.
Yeah, most of that was. I think I did add a couple lines based on some emails
I
today.
Chart. You had these things in the back that I could read them.
Sure. Yes, we can get you to answer your question. We certainly can. Now, obviously, we want the neighborhoods to be able to go back and forth. That's part of the interconnectivity. That's really the beauty of it. And what we want to do is to minimize the cut-through traffic, and that analysis we just gave you is really not too much based on whether traffic would be willing to cut through a neighborhood. So we want to make it a little bit more difficult to cut through that neighborhood. Obviously, we can post signs and that sort of thing in terms of to let people know that it is a neighborhood, but from a practical standpoint, what will they be doing? Well, first of all, they're going to need to come down and I'll go back here to this graphic. If they're coming from this area here, for instance, and they're going to turn right, this neighborhood right in here, if they turn right onto Columbus Road, Columbus Road itself is a fairly long, straight roadway with uninterrupted sight lines, and I know that people have been concerned about the speed on that road. It's currently, obviously, a dead-end road, but still, you can get up some pretty good speeds probably on the road. So we'll talk about that in a little bit, some of the potential traffic calming measures that you might be able to use for a road like that, typically. As you go, though, down Columbus, you're going to need to stop. We propose to stop, certainly, at the intersection of Columbus and Kildare. And then you go down Kildare to where the two Kildares, if you will, come together at this corner. This Kildare coming into Kildare and Chicory, we would propose a stop sign there so that the through road, if you will be from Kildare onto Chicory or Chicory onto Kildare. Now, you'll note that there is a horizontal sort of curve here. That's one of the things you do try to do with neighborhoods, to curve the roadways so it slows traffic down and makes it so that it's not quite as quick to go through. And it really helps identify it's a neighborhood. To begin with, the roadway is relatively narrow. It's 22 feet wide, but it also has a curb on it, on each side of it. Now, that makes people sort of feel a little bit, what we call a little shy factor. You don't want to be right on top of that curb. So as a practical standpoint, your road width from the center line is probably more like, 10 feet, because it's 22 feet curb to curb. So it's not, you don't feel like you have a lot of room, so that tends to slow you down. You're going to need to stop again at Chicory Way. Then you need to turn, and there's a crosswalk there. You'll turn the corner, and you go around the curve, and you'll come up to what we're calling a raised crosswalk at this location, which is simply a crosswalk that's raised up by about 4 inches or so, and it has a flat top on it. The flat top, it's the width of the crosswalk itself. Typically, you design those so that traffic can't quite go that speed limit. It depends on how you design it. But oftentimes, in a residential neighborhood like this, you'll design them for around 15 miles an hour. You go over that, and then obviously you've got to go around this horizontal curve, which is a fairly sharp curve. It's in accordance with the ordinance, but it's still a fairly sharp curve, and it's a narrow roadway. Then we're going to go down and stop, make a left-hand turn here down Dermot Drive, around another sharp corner, down Hamlin. And then we're going to come out onto Stevenson, where we have to stop yet again and make a left turn. Then we're going to go down Stevenson till we get to Spurwink, and we're going to stop there. And I was going to go over the intersection of Spurwink with you a little bit later. So there's a lot of stops, there's a lot of circuity to this, and that's one of the reasons that we don't think a lot of people are really going to want to cut through it. It's got a neighborhood flavor. So I think the analysis we've done is pretty conservative. Now, another question is, how can we address the traffic on Columbus? How can we maybe slow that down or discourage people from using that? It's a lot of different traffic calming sorts of techniques, and traffic calming is being used in more and more communities. Traffic calming, for the most part, is appropriate for local roadways, not so much for, you know, collectors or arterials. You really wouldn't want to put them, for instance, too much on Route 1. You're probably not going to even put them on something like Mitchell Road, if you will. But for residential roadways, they certainly are appropriate. And some of the things that we can do is multi-way stop signs. We're making use of some of those, as we mentioned. Another thing is chicanes. We talked about that in our report a little bit about a chicane. And I don't know, did you bring a copy with that? Okay. Yep, I see that. Now, to go over the what a chicane might be, a chicane really is sort of a bump out on one side of the road, and then there's a bump out a little further down the street, okay, on the other side of the road. Now, Columbus Road is about 24 feet wide, and these bump outs typically are going to be something in the order of 4 to 6 feet, so you narrow the road down at those points. But the other thing it does, by altering the side of the street you're putting them on, you can landscape those areas. So you're breaking up the visual sight line as you look down Columbus Road. That's something they do in some communities. They've done it a fair amount in Europe, just to try to break that up. That's one option. Landscaping itself along the side of the roadway,
Just very quickly, are there examples of chicanes locally that we might be able to take a look at?
Real locally?
On the racetrack?
Right.
What was that?
That aren't on a racetrack.
That aren't on the racetrack. Real locally, I don't know of any that are right locally that you could look at, but I certainly can get you some examples.
Even a few photographs might be helpful.
Okay. Yeah, I'd be happy to.
Okay. Thank you.
I had a question about when two cars pass each other, can you pass at a chicane?
It's a good question. I'll get up to another one where you can't, but in a chicane, yes, you can. In other words, if you've got a 24-foot wide roadway, and we take at the first one where we're going to be on this side, if you will, of Columbus, if you're traveling down Columbus, it'd be on your right-hand side, I'd probably pull that out something in the order of 6 feet. That means you've got about 18 feet remaining. So you're going to swing out around that a little bit, but you're going to come to the next one, which is located fairly close proximity, which is, you know, curves you around the other way. Again, by those sticking out now, we've got six on this side, six on that side. If you landscape them, then you're cutting down that visual corridor by half, from 24 feet to 12 feet, because you've cut in 6 feet on each side. To answer your question, you certainly can pass two cars within the 18 feet. Now, landscaping is another technique. If you have landscaping along adjacent to a roadway, it absolutely helps to slow traffic down. It's not something you want to do on, again, a higher speed roadway, because they're known as deadly fixed objects. They don't want people running into them, so you have to maintain a clear zone. But on a residential street like this, they're helpful in slowing people down. Another technique is the road width itself. As I've mentioned, the narrower the road, the slower people go. And that's one of the reasons we just have a 22-foot road curb to curb. There's a physical barrier against each side, so you really have effectively a 20-foot road in terms of being able to utilize it. Another technique is speed humps and speed tables. The only difference between a speed hump is a speed hump is more abrupt, it's just a continuous curve. A speed table has a flat top on the top of it. They're also, we're using it a little bit in the proposed development as a raised crosswalk. Sometimes they have a slightly longer top than a raised crosswalk does, but they're raised up again about 4 inches. Sidewalks in and of themselves are not traffic calming, but if you combine them like with Esplanade and you're narrowing the roadway and putting in trees and that sort of thing, then they certainly can contribute. Chokers, to answer your question, a choker, two cars can't pass. And that's deliberate in a residential neighborhood, sort of like a one-way bridge. You have a one-way bridge up in Topsom, where Brunswick, I should say. And that's all you can do is one-way traffic, and it works. And that's the theory here, is there's several of those that I've seen. You wouldn't think they'd work, but they seem to work fairly well. And obviously, people slow down quite a bit with those. A little dramatic, but it does tend to work. And I've already talked about raised crosswalks. So those are some of the techniques that could be looked at on Columbus and generally are in your toolbox, if you will, when you're trying to accomplish traffic calming on a residential roadway. The board also asked if it would be appropriate to utilize a one-way loop system for South Road and Hamlin Street. Generally, one-way loop systems are usually done more in high-speed arterials, sometimes higher-speed collectors, for signal progression, or in an urban setting where you've got you want to have on-street parking, and you don't have room for two-way traffic plus the on-street parking, you'll sometimes go to it. One of the negative effects is that it does tend to increase speed a bit when you have one-way traffic, because the two-way traffic does tend to create some friction, if you will, and slow people down. We wouldn't recommend it. We don't think it's appropriate in this particular location. There was also a question as to the intersection of Stevenson and Spurwink in terms of how much trimming are we going to need to do there to achieve sight lines? This graphic represents, it depicts the intersection of Spurwink Road with Stevenson. And the issue, this is Stevenson, again, Spurwink. There's a sharp curve on Spurwink, which actually is posted as you go around that corner about 20 miles per hour. There's an advisory 20 mile an hour posted speed limit. There is vegetation on the inside of that curve. What that does is it, and there's also vegetation along this side of Spurwink Road. Those two things combined have a couple of effects. One is that it's, as you're looking to the left, as you're exiting Stevenson Street, it does restrict the sight lines. Now, you could improve them dramatically by removing the vegetation, but that vegetation obviously is important to people. And so we don't necessarily want to do that. It's an existing sightline deficiency, but there are other ways you could accomplish it, which I'll go over in a minute. As you're exiting Stevenson, you also have an issue as you look to the right, a similar type of issue. There's some mailboxes, but there's a lot of vegetation there that, again, restricts your sightlines. And finally, sightlines are restricted by people that, for people, I should say, that want to turn left from Spurwink onto Stevenson, again, trying to look around the corner. In the house here, obviously, that vegetation is very important to that house. So what we've looked at, while you could trim some of that vegetation, again, it's difficult when you're doing that. It's important to the homeowner. So we tried to look at it and see what else we could do. We're recommending a three-way stop at that location at this point. And that would correct the problem. We wouldn't need as much in the way of sight lines, and they would be positioned at the intersection of Stevenson and Spurwink itself. We would have the stop bars, stop signs, and such. Now, we would also have a couple of warning signs. One, as you approach Spurwink from each direction, they would be actuated warning signs that would have flashing lights. They would flash when they detect an approaching vehicle. So it would just come on as you approach it, well before you get to the sign, picks your vehicle up, comes on flashing, just advising you that this is stop on ahead. We thought that was maybe better than just having them flash all the time, and that's because, similar to school flashing signs, they become part of the landscape if they're running all the time. This just picks up your car, so it's only when a car is there that they're actually flashing. There was also a question about the sight lines at Mitchell Road with Columbus. What's shown here is part of Columbus, and this is Mitchell Road going through here. And the surveyor, Owen Haskell, went out and did a survey of that. We plotted a profile, which is all in your report. The roadway, as we talked about the last time, drops off. It begins to drop off relatively about here, and drops off more rapidly as you get up into this portion. The current sight lines are about 180 feet there, which don't meet the standard today. And what we're proposing, it would take some clearing here, and there's really not any other way to accomplish it at that location, would be to take some clearing and some a limited amount of stone wall and be working with that. this sightline stays within the right-of-way at that point. If it got out of the right-of-way, it wouldn't do you any good because the roadway begins to fall off, so you're going to lose them because of the vertical anyway. So I think the peer review done by Mr. Errico indicated that that was an acceptable solution, but he'd like to see, you know, the landscaping plan that we would have to go along with that. I think with that answers most of the questions I believe that the board had asked us to look into. I believe there was a peer review done as well on the methods that I just went over with, and I think the result of that was that they generally concurred with the methods and findings. And there was a, with the exception of how we treat Columbus in terms of traffic calming treatments along that roadway, which, you know, I would defer certainly to this board as well as the people that live along the roadway. Happy to answer it, or I guess I was going to turn it back to John.
I'd just like to take a couple minutes and sort of recap the planning process to date and where we are at this point. On August 2nd, 2005, we had our first planning board workshop meeting. On September 1st, we held a neighborhood informational meeting in this room. On September 6th, we had our second planning board meeting, workshop meeting, basically with revisions that were made to the plan based on comments that were made by the board at the first workshop meeting, as well as neighborhood comments. On October 28th, we submitted our preliminary subdivision application and resource protection permit application. On November 15th, our application was deemed complete. On December 10th, we conducted a site visit with the planning board. On December 13th, we received approval from the Conservation Commission by a vote of 5-0. On December 20th, the planning board conducted a public hearing. Subsequent to that, we, with a great deal of effort, we revised our stormwater management plan in accordance with the request made by the planning board. We've had substantive discussions with the planning board during the months of December, January, and now February. A peer review of the wetlands has been performed by David Roque, State of Maine soil scientist. A peer review of the traffic has been completed by Tom Errico, concurring with Tom Gorrell's methods and findings. With the exception of a few minor technical comments by Steve Harding, we've addressed all of staff comments, planning board comments, as well as several comments expressed by the neighbors. Finally, we have prepared these plans and application documentation based upon satisfying the criteria established by both zoning and subdivision ordinances. So based on the above, we are seeking preliminary subdivision approval and approval for a resource protection permit this evening, and respectfully request that the board vote on this tonight. Thank you. I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you. I just wanted to point out to the members of the planning board that with us tonight in the audience are the police chief, the fire chief, and the deputy fire chief, and Mr. Errico, who did the peer review study of the traffic reports. So if anyone has questions for any of those individuals, you're certainly welcome to raise them now, or for the applicant as well.
Yes, I don't know, Mr. Errico, the graph that Tom put up there, that showed an increase in traffic of 8 times, I think, from the current situation at Stevenson and Spurwink.
Yes, yes.
The road system that's currently in place there, the town road system that is there, is you're happy with their assessment of what, how much traffic is going to come through there, and that the road system can handle that traffic.
For the record, my name is Tom Errico, senior traffic engineer with Wilbur Smith Associates.
Quite frankly, I do. I think, in some of my earlier correspondence, I indicated that I did expect some cut-through traffic to happen in early December, and I continue to think that will happen. But I believe that looking at the roadway structure within Cape Elizabeth and the area, looking at what's being proposed in terms of the proposed roadway system within the project, and also what I think needs to happen in terms of Columbus Road and some traffic calming, I don't see a significant amount of cut-through traffic that would occur. In terms of Tom's estimates, whether it be over close to Spurwink, the roadway system can handle that additional traffic. There really isn't a capacity issue in terms of traffic. Things that come up in terms of cut-through traffic or added traffic from a development, quite frankly, tends to be more speed-related than anything. So I think some of the things that they're implementing as part of the roadway design, I think will help to curtail speeding.
I'd like to segue on that. Those are two tiny little streets. I'm on the other side. I'm on the Stevenson side with Hamlin and McDermott. And we're talking about 1,060 cars going through that area in a day. That seems like an enormous amount of traffic to me.
Many things are relative in terms of
in that tiny area that seems enormous. Yeah. You're a traffic engineer. I'm not. I'm just responding as an individual who might have to live on those streets. I can tell you I wouldn't want to live on them.
And like I said, things are relative, and certainly people that live on Columbus Road or Hamlin will.
I'm not talking about Columbus right now. I'm only talking about Hamlin and.
Hamlin will see. They'll see an increase. I don't think there's any question about it. Do I think it'll create capacity problems or safety problems? I don't. That volume itself won't reach a level where the roadway capacity will fail, and create congestion problems. Now I think, and I've said this in my correspondence that they need to implement certain treatments. I don't think
there's
anything that really is necessary. I think the roadway system is pretty much set up in terms of dealing with vehicular speeds. I think Columbus Road in particular is a street that needs some attention. And they've come up with a proposal. I don't think the town staff finds the proposal acceptable. I think there are other options in terms of traffic calming that need to be explored and looked at.
Well, to me, and maybe this isn't a question to ask you, but the town has sort of nixed everything. I mean, they've looked at the chicanes, and I don't know if that's a very good solution, but they nixed them. The sidewalks are no good because they have to clear them. Something about we don't implement, which I don't even know what that means, speed tables, and yet they're putting them in. They're going to allow them in a new subdivision. I don't understand.
Yeah, I think
that's a question I have for the town.
Yeah, and I can't respond for the town, but I can tell you that I've had some meetings with the town about traffic calming treatments. A lot of communities have some reluctance about trying new treatments. I think they see the treatment that's being proposed in the site development on South Street as sort of an experimental type design. It may be something that they find that works very well at that location, and then they'll expand it to other roadways in the community. But certainly there are hosts, and Tom talked about it, there are a host of options in terms of coming up with some solution in terms of calming traffic.
But it doesn't, and we'll need to hear from the town. It doesn't seem like very much latitude. There may be ideas for ways of dealing with it.
Yeah, I haven't seen any correspondence. I haven't seen any correspondence from the town, so I'm not sure what they indicated.
Before we leave that topic, Mr. Errico, what traffic calming measures would you recommend for the Columbus Road way, which is obviously seems to be the major concern on your part?
Yeah, I think I've stated it in earlier correspondence that I thought about maybe some sort of sidewalk treatment with supplemental landscaping and streetscape treatment to kind of change the visual character of the street. I currently administer the traffic calming program in Portland. Pretty big program, and we get a lot of requests. And quite honestly, you know the programs that get developed are neighborhood based. The residents get involved in the decision making and ultimately decide what the street ought to look like. And I think to some degree that ought to happen here. I shouldn't be the one deciding what ought to happen on that street. I think the people that live on that street ought to participate and decide what ought to happen. And so, thinking about some of the you know, the streets that we've changed in Portland and other communities, that's been something that has been implemented, that has resulted in improvement in terms of reducing speed and provides some visual improvement in terms of context sensitive improvements for the neighborhood. So that's something that I said it in my letter. I haven't done any feasibility analysis. I don't know about right of way. I don't know about impact. So in terms of implementation of that, you know, again I'm not sure about it, but that's something that I think ought to be explored. I know raised treatments are something that are new for the community. I personally support them, use them quite frequently throughout the state, and I personally don't have a problem with that type of treatment. So there's a couple examples.
David.
Excuse me, while you're on the subject, Stephen's at Portland.
Sure.
What's the result of those raised?
They've as you well know, that project is infamous in its history. There's been great success in terms of dealing with vehicular speeds and pedestrian safety, because that was again there are many elements of it, but it's been good.
I have one quick question here. You said under I in your letter, and I can't find it anywhere. Maybe it was removed earlier. Chapman Street installation of stop signs and horizontal signs. My professional opinion. Now that wasn't mentioned. You didn't mention that, Mr. Burrell, but is that out of the picture now?
Is that out?
It reads.
That's a Hamlin curve. The curve on Hamlin.
Horizontal curve. In my professional opinion.
You have a map of that section.
It's an unusual treatment to address a geometric deficiency.
Oh, here. Okay. Yeah. This one is not in there. Okay. We responded to Tom.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Just a quick question on the chart behind you.
Sure.
I just want to, because there's been some talk about the figure of over 1,000 trips, the net change from the development, is that the 300 number that's below that? I can't even.
No, that's the net change from what was originally estimated in the original traffic impact study. So after going through the process of figuring out the cut through traffic and making some other changes in terms of reassignment of traffic within a development, I believe that's what that 380 represents.
So if this development were to be approved, how many more trips per day would you see at Stevenson Street?
Currently, right now, there's 250 cars on a daily basis. So, 1060 minus 250 would be your addition.
Paul,
Tom, one of the looking at your review of Tom's proposed solution at Stevenson and Spurwink, in your opinion, are the flashing lights something that you think is an absolute necessity?
You know, any time you install a treatment that is somewhat unusual, professionally, I do get a little concerned about people obeying the regulatory signs, and so I think any kind of added advice, notification, I think is a good thing. I recognize that there's some concern about the flashing lights and the impact it may have on some abutting properties. I'd be willing to recommend not having them installed initially and then kind of and monitoring the situation. And if problems develop, then have them installed at a later date and obviously the cost paid by the applicant.
David, another question?
Yes, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Again, I know that Tom Grohl has gone to great lengths to estimate cut-through traffic and knowing how difficult that is. Again, I do believe that the estimate is reasonable and representative. Would you concur with my thoughts that even if Tom's estimate were somehow low and that there were a greater volume, that these intersections do have a fair amount of additional capacity to handle extra traffic if that were to concur? Obviously, it's not something I would deem as being desired, but do these intersections have a fair amount of excess capacity?
Yeah, you know, again, Tom Goral did a pretty extensive analysis of capacity, level of service analysis at the intersections, and clearly there's excess capacity, and I would tend to agree that if his estimate is off, I think I don't foresee a capacity problem developing at any point.
Just for information, what is the point where you have to start thinking about a light in traffic?
Yeah, there are specific warrants that are established by the Federal Highway Administration, and they're generally safe, they're either accident crash based or volume based. And quite frankly, you need a lot of volume. You need a lot of volume.
We're not anywhere near that.
No, you know we're near.
How do you respond to, I believe it was one of the abutters at our prior public hearing said that it may not be appropriate just to look at cut-through traffic that goes to the mall area or cut-through traffic that goes to Fort Williams. There's more locally based cut-through traffic, to say, to get to a baseball field or our downtown area. How do you figure that into the mix?
I've said it, there'll be cut-through traffic. I don't think there's any question. I think there'll be more of that kind of cut-through traffic than I think traffic that'll be going to the mall, quite frankly, because I just look at the system and I look at the proposed roadway network, and it just doesn't feel right to me. But it'll happen. There'll be some, and I think it'll be somewhat limited, and I think it's quite frankly the responsibility to try to design the roadway system appropriately to handle it, and that'll, I think, control itself. That'll be a mechanism to control, the cut-through traffic. I just don't sense, in evaluating Tom's information and data, that it's going to be a serious, significant problem.
Does anybody have more questions for Mr. Erica?
It has to do with sidewalk. It has to do with Columbus and sidewalks. I don't know.
Sure.
You might have. Well, it has had more to do with, I think, in the December 20th meeting, there, I think you asked for some input from Columbus Road neighbors and others in the area about what they kind of felt about some of these proposals. And I don't know if we've really seen very much from... We've seen a lot from the neighborhood, that's for sure, but I'm not sure we've seen anything that has said, how is that handled? Do we put something out that says, this, would you like to see this, 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 or this, rather than just nothing? How do you elicit some kind of response from a neighborhood on choices?
Sure. Barbara?
Well, I have a question for the applicant. Have you made an effort to meet with people in the neighborhood? I know that it's become very fractious, but have you made an effort to meet with the people in the neighborhood, to have a neighborhood meeting, to say, what can we do to work with you to make this project more acceptable? Has there been such a meeting? And I don't mean here in this room, I mean outside of it. Has there been?
No, there has not.
Has there been any effort made to contact the people by you in that area to ask them for any of their ideas, positive ideas or thoughts?
The only thing that I can say to that is that there have been several comments made to the applicants favoring speed tables. Or speed bumps or speed tables in the area. We have not received a consensus from the neighborhood saying or requesting that sidewalks be incorporated onto Columbus. Sidewalks will require narrowing the roadway by 2 feet. It will require some removal of their front yards. It will impact, I think, on on-street parking.
Well, I'm not suggesting any particular method. I'm just saying, has there been an effort? And you've answered me, there has not
been
an effort.
There has not been.
To have a neighborhood meeting initiated by you, because you're asking them to make changes in their neighborhood.
And we would be willing to do that.
John?
Yes.
Go ahead.
A couple of questions. Some comments made tonight about Mitchell Road the intersection, but it doesn't show on your plan. Is that something that you people will do? Is that what you were planning to do, or is that something that the town would do? The intersection of Columbus and Mitchell, the site situation?
I think that's something that we would do. We'd work with the town, the Public Works Department, on that, but that's something that we would do, yes.
How about it's growing and Stevens?
Same, yeah.
I just have a concern with that intersection that's at Dermot and Spring, and I think, or South Street, and my understanding is that there won't be a stop sign there?
There will not be a stop sign in this approach here. There will be a stop sign in this approach.
The only concern I have is, and it came up in our hearing, that South Street won't be improved beyond that hammerhead at lot number one. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Might it be helpful to have a stop sign there? I'm not a traffic engineer, coming down South Street prior to Dermot, and giving people a chance to stop and maybe see what they're going to run into if they continue down south. It might be easier for them.
You're talking here or up here?
Right there.
Right here. We actually would be willing, certainly, to put one there. The thought was that they're going to be going, obviously, very slow to make the left turn anyway, but I have absolutely no problem with the stop sign.
Those people that have never come through the neighborhood before, and then that was a shortcut, and all of a sudden, goes down and hit a dirt road.
Yep, I wouldn't have a problem with that.
But I just make that as a suggestion.
Yep.
I just want to make a comment. The town has had an experience with slowing traffic here in the town center when they put the sidewalks in, and I think Maureen can speak to this. I believe when they put this new sidewalk on the other side of Ocean House here, and the trees, and narrowed the road by, what was it, 4 feet, or was it?
It varied.
But it did, actually, the test showed that the traffic slowed down, right?
We've never measured it, but the police chief is in the audience. And
it seems to me, if the board would indulge me, this would be a perfect segue. We do have some of the town officials here. We're talking about these various options for calming traffic, and since they're here and it's getting to be late, I wonder if either the police chief, fire chief, deputy fire chief would be willing to speak to some of these traffic calming measures that have been discussed tonight. Chief Williams?
Yes, for the record, Neil Williams, police chief. Looking at the traffic calming measures, it was my opinion that I thought stop signs would be the best feature in down the Columbus Road area, Thrasher Road, Kildare, in that particular venue going down through and coming back out, stopping traffic. I believe that's what Bob Malley wrote in his memo. I don't have them in front of me, but that's what we thought would work best. It's less maintenance for the town after this project is turned over its hands, and it's just a cheaper way of doing things.
Is the primary concern about the option of sidewalks than the cost of maintenance on a go-forward basis?
That would be Bob Malley's through his direction. I believe, if I can speak to him just briefly, that's one of his concerns was maintenance issues after the fact, taking care of the sidewalks, taking care of the esplanade. It's more additional work for him and his crew.
David?
We have that memo.
Did you want me to read what his comments were?
You can, but I mean, if you have them in front of you, then that's fine.
We have it.
However, I let Bob speak for Bob.
Barbara?
Maureen, what is the meaning of "we do not implement vertical traffic calming measures"?
No speed tables.
Why?
Public Works Director doesn't, well.
Are you going to speak for him?
No, no. The and we should probably ask Police Chief any other issues he has, but the Town Manager, the Public Works Director, the Police Chief, the Fire Chief, and the town's traffic engineer met to discuss the potential traffic calming measures on this project. And I believe, I'm going to get in trouble no matter what. I believe the answer was that the speed tables were discouraged because there was no policies in place for how they would be installed, and if they were installed here, all neighborhoods would want them. However, staff stretched themselves as far as they could by agreeing to allow the raised crosswalk, which functions like a speed table, at the intersection of Franklin Circle and the South Street in the Spurwink Woods project. And they said, we're going to treat this as experimental and see how it works. And on a more long-range plan, there is somewhere on someone's list a project to come up with policies regarding vertical speed control in the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And I'd like to reiterate that Maureen hit that right on the head. I believe, and I don't want to speak for Mike either, it seems like I'm right up here on the limelight, but it is, I believe, one of the council goals to take that up and to look at that, because I know you raised an eye as far as other areas getting them, but that's true. If they were implemented in one area, they'd be all over the place.
And is the concern in that respect, Maureen, because they might be too effective?
I would
decline
I was going to try to bail Maureen out of that. I would defer that to Mike, because Mike definitely stated that he wanted to make sure before any of those went in, the council looked at it and determined a policy on where and how they would be installed.
But
no, go ahead.
The point we're trying to make, though, is on a new project. I mean, frankly, that's the council's bailiwick as far as I'm concerned. Our task is to determine whether it makes sense in this project. Mm-hmm. That the political fallout is for the politicians to deal with.
Barbara?
Well, the problem is that we can look at Spurwink Woods as an entity by itself, and it's not. It's part of a larger community, and we have to try to make a decision that is rational and wise, not just for Spurwink Woods, but for the abutting people, and to be told, you know, well, nobody wants this, and the council has to decide that. It ties our hands and makes our decision-making almost impossible.
But they're not saying we can't decide that. What they're saying...
Well, if it has to go to the council and...
No, for future, for other neighborhoods.
Well, but Columbus and is another neighborhood.
Meaning,
Mitchell Highlands is another neighborhood. It isn't Spurwink Woods.
The amendments
Woods.
Are now part of this project.
I just want that to be clear.
Paul?
And I guess, and again, obviously, we don't have a strong sense from what the folks in these neighborhoods would like to see. If anything, again, obviously, a lot of correspondence has come across, you know, our desks relative to, you know, obviously not wanting the project, not wanting cut-through traffic, certainly understand that. From my perspective, you know, speed tables, speed humps, you know, vertical-type devices are extremely effective in controlling speed. I understand a policy is probably a good thing, but I think we do have the opportunity as a planning board relative to this project to, again, if the communities are, you know, so willing to you know, look at these to suggest that these might be good ways of controlling speed and ultimately reducing cut-through traffic through this neighborhood.
I just wanted to hear your thoughts on the flashing lights to warn drivers of the Stevenson-Spurwink intersection. What are your thoughts on that?
I have seen flashing lights in the past. I think of the one in Belgrade. When you come to that corner, it always flashes, so I know what Tom Errico is talking about. But we mentioned at that particular staff meeting that if those lights were too distracting to the neighbors, could they be shut off? And they said yes, they could. And that would be my only concern as to the effect on the neighbors. I think we saw the maps and sketches on where they would be located, and I think they were located near a telephone pole because they would grab the power off of that pole, but that might not necessarily be the correct spot to put that for a neighbor.
But it's only going to flash when a car comes by, right?
Yeah, but if you're sitting in your living room watching TV and it only flashes when a car goes by, but a car goes by, you might not like that.
I just had one other question on the stop sign that would be located on Columbus Road, sort of at the midpoint where Killdeer that comes in to Columbus Road?
Yes.
There was a concern expressed that people might just ignore that and kind of... I know in my own neighborhood, I'm not guilty of this myself, of course, but you're coming down Hunts Point Road, you see the stop sign before you get to Winding Way, and you often see people just kind of moving on through.
I think that would have to be an enforcement issue that we would take care of on a basis. I know that South Portland's been doing some traffic enforcement on certain locations where people have been running lights, and it's an enforcement issue that you would have to have special details for. And I think if we put several stop signs up in that area, that people would get used to them at a particular time and in the future, and we'd do an enforcement action on it. However, in most enforcement actions that we've found in neighborhoods such as this or your area, it's usually the people that live in that area that are the offenders. Nothing against.
I understand. Any other questions for the police chief? I'm not going to ask anymore.
He's going to be watching.
No.
Oh, sure. The town planner did remind me about the notion of an emergency gate concept for controlling cut-through traffic.
I am not in favor of gates. As you know, we have one in the Broad Cove area, and we have found that they are just not what you need when you need it. Take, for instance, last night, and I am throwing out a hypothetical that may happen never, but last night was 0 degrees. If you have rain and you have 0 degrees, the lock might freeze on that. If we are there at that particular end of the gate trying to get through to a rescue and the lock doesn't work, then we've got to take the time to get back in the car and go all the way around. At least Broad Cove, you have an exit or an entrance that's not too far down the road. In this particular issue, you have to go all the way around. And if it was an electric gate, those get damaged. It's a big maintenance issue. Keys get lost. It's just not a safe thing. I don't believe on public safety issues.
Does anybody have any other questions for?
If I could mention one other thing,
sure,
about gates that we've run into and other issues. People say if you need it, why don't you just open it? And say it's in the summertime. Well, when we're at a call, we can't take the time to go down there and open the gate for somebody else to get out or get in. So I'd just like to mention that issue that, you know, if we're at an emergency, we got a house fire and we're blocking traffic down the other way, but there's an ambulance call that needs to come in a different way, we just don't have the time to do that. Mm-hmm. We don't have the personnel to do that.
Thank you. I don't know if the fire department wanted to weigh in on any of these traffic calming measures.
I just make one comment from the fire department, and the comment is that there's a lot of equipment on a fire truck, and when you're going over speed tables and bumps, everything goes everywhere, and it's extremely dangerous to the people in the truck and the equipment in it, and we would much prefer the stop signs than we would the speed tables or the speed bumps.
Okay, thank you.
What do you think of chicanes? I say that half kiddingly, but all seriously.
That wouldn't bother us. I know that the Public Works Director has a number of concerns with that.
Okay. Thank you. Is there any other questions for the applicant, for Mr. Errico or the other officials here? Barbara?
I don't see that.
Okay. Okay. Anything else related to traffic? Okay. Ben, go ahead.
My question is, because we've never done this before, I don't know how it works. We have two amendments attached to this proposal now, which have not been discussed at all. And I'm not sure how they're dealt with. And those are the amendments to change Mitchell Highlands subdivision by taking in one lot and allowing another, and having the easement from the second lot. And then the South Street subdivision, taking in those lots. And how does that work in terms of the application? That it just gets mentioned as part of the points in here along with the rest of them? Or is it just dealt with? I just don't know how to deal with it, how we're supposed to deal with it.
Would you be willing to respond? Sure.
The way I would handle it is the way we handle any review of any project. It's not unusual for, especially a large subdivision, to have subdivision review, resource protection permit, private access way permits, and this is just, I mean, you could be issuing floodplain permits. This is just one more thing that we put in the list, and the policy of the town has been to do concurrent review of all of those issues that a project needs review at one time. So at the point when the town makes a motion for approval, you would make a finding that all of the standards of subdivision review have been met for each of those amendments.
For an amendment?
Yes. Yeah, there's two different amendments. So you'd be making a finding of a substantial compliance with 16.3.1 for the subdivision, major subdivision review. You'd make a motion of compliance with the standards of section 16.3.1 for the amendment to the Mitchell Highlands subdivision. You would do the same thing for the amendment to the South Portland Estates subdivision. You'd be making a motion of findings that substantially complies with section 19.8.3 of the resource protection permit standards for the resource protection permit. Okay.
Those amendments are at final approval. They don't get preliminary approval on amendments.
Well, we usually just package them all as one piece. Technically, you're right, a resource protection permit does not have preliminary approval and final approval. It just has final approval. But we usually just, once you put them together, we don't take them apart, because then you forget them.
I wouldn't want to do that, but I just wanted Barbara to understand that we might not necessarily, because we're at preliminary stage, mm-hmm. voting on the amendments specifically. Is that accurate?
If you don't want to do it, I mean, the way I would draft the motion for the board to consider would be to list every single approval that's currently before you.
Okay.
And even though it doesn't I don't think you're prohibited from granting preliminary approval. It doesn't mean anything.
I understand.
Answer your question?
Well, it answers that question about process. Yes, thank you. That's what I asked.
One of the issues that was raised at the conclusion of Mr. Mitchell's presentation was they are seeking a vote tonight on preliminary subdivision approval. And just curious to hear from the board as to whether they believe we're ready to move forward on that or whether other options need to be pursued.
You want a motion and then see what the board...
Oh. Finish your comment, Dave.
I didn't quite hear you, I'm sorry.
Want a motion and to see, and then see what the board has to say about it? Are you ready at this point, or you want some more discussion?
Well, I think I'd like to hear some discussion first.
Well, my...
Go ahead.
The first point of discussion is, I think we need to confront the issue of, and we've had some substantial amendments, and I think we at least need to put on the table the issue of additional public comments on the changes. Several emails and letters have come to the board concerning whether we have the discretion to open the public hearing again to take additional comments. I would favorably consider that as long as the comments were limited to the changes that we've seen, and we've seen some substantial, the two major changes on the stormwater drainage plan and the additional traffic information, but not to reopen it to bring up every issue from the beginning of the project till today, because I don't think that's fair to the applicant or to the other neighbors that have come out and spoken already. But I wanted to know both from the chair and from the planning director what the procedural devices we need to do in order to do that, if it's even possible. I've read several different things in emails, and I don't know whether we have the discretion to do that and then put it to a vote if that's possible.
I agree 100%.
The last time this issue came up was for another subdivision. Mm-hmm. I believe it was Blueberry Ridge. It's the only time I recall ever having a discussion about whether an additional public hearing should be held. In that particular case, we decided not to, but I don't recall whether there was any discussion as to whether we could. So I may direct that question back to the town planner as to whether we have the capacity, if the board members are so inclined, to allow more public comment before we have a vote on preliminary subdivision approval. Mm-hmm.
After the board deems an application complete, you have 30 days to hold a public hearing. And then following the public hearing, you have another 30 days where you can table the application to consider the application. Following that period, you can only table an application with the mutual consent of the applicant.
Mm-hmm.
So if you wanted to table this application to hold another public hearing, I believe you have every right to do so as long as the applicant concedes to tabling it for another month. But you can hold another public hearing in order to allow the public to address new substantial information.
But does that involve a separate meeting, meaning do we have to come back for that, or is it possible?
Yes, if you're going to hold a public hearing, you want to provide legal notice of that public hearing, which has not been provided tonight. So otherwise, it's not really a public hearing. The other thing I need to remind the board is that there's a two-step approval process.
Right.
And the final approval phase, it's typical for the board to hold a public hearing so that the public has an opportunity to comment on the plan, usually just before the board takes a vote, so they get to have a comment on pretty much the end result of the plans. So
if we move forward tonight with considering preliminary approval, there still would probably be, or definitely be, another public opportunity.
You're not required to hold another public hearing as part of final approval, but I would strongly urge you.
Yeah, in this case, especially if we decided not to.
Yes.
I can't imagine us not doing that. But
Barbara?
Well, I understand and I appreciate John's wanting and the applicant's wanting to move forward, certainly. This is a large project for Cape Elizabeth, and it may not move quite to everybody's appreciation. However, I don't think we're even there in terms of what's going to happen with traffic. I mean, we have no response from the abutters on both sides about what kinds of things might work. We have negatives from the town employees, which I'm not sure should matter that much to us in terms of how we make a decision about this project, if we feel very strongly about it. There is a speed bump in Cape Elizabeth, and it works very well. It happens to be on a private road, and it does work. And we've had no trouble with it in terms of plowing our road or anything else. And I think we need to settle these things regardless of the applicant's eagerness, and I understand it in getting going on, because we have to make a very weighty decision about this project. And if we do that, if everybody agrees that we should in fact get some response back about how the developers are going to deal with the situation with the abutters on both sides, then I definitely think we ought to give people a chance to speak to traffic and the traffic calming measures and the change in the stormwater drainage plan, because both of those are substantial. That's my opinion.
Peter?
Assuming that we get that input between now and the, any consideration of a final plan, is that something you would be comfortable with, Barbara, in terms of giving them, considering preliminary approval tonight, but saying that we need public, more public input into what specifically they're looking for? I mean, one of the difficulties I see in that is, you know, frankly, we can't even get agreement among the town heads of department as to what specific things they want. And then, you know, at some point, we're going to have to make those decisions. But I agree with you. I don't even have a clear sense of what the town officials...
We give preliminary approval when a major portion of this is not even...
Because in general, we agree that we can discuss, and I'm not saying we should or should not approve anything because we haven't put a motion on the table, but I'm saying in principle, you could say that there are certain traffic calming techniques that we're going to consider as part of preliminary approval. This isn't final approval. We haven't said you got to put them here, you got to put them there, you have to put a speed table here. I'm saying in principle we could say this is what we like in the plan, this is what we're going to be insisting on the plan between now and the next stage, which is a consideration of a final plan. That's when we come up with it's going here, it's going there. That would be my view on how to procedurally move this forward. And we don't even have a motion on the table, but.
Dave.
Can I add one thing, though? I think the way I read what the town officials say is that they accept what's on the plans now as calming methods. Mm. And that they're not going to deal with the issue until this is finished. And they're going to deal with it politically. But they accept, I think, what I hear, they accept other than the fact that, you know, they may have some problems with the fire trucks going over it or the. But right now, they accept what's proposed on these plans, and that's all we have to look at.
Sure.
At this point. And I see no reason to not approve it for that reason. There may be other reasons, but not for that reason.
I agree with you.
John, I guess the question that I would have and that other board members would be having is whether you would consent to a tabling of the...
Before I answer that, I'd just like to mention there have been a couple points just discussed. One is stormwater management. We did change the plan based on the board's recommendation, a request. It has been peer-reviewed. You have Steve Harding's comments in front of you. Basically, the only thing that's lacking from the stormwater management plan are the final details that are associated with that. With regard to the traffic, Tom has addressed essentially all of your concerns and questions regarding traffic, cut through, and all of the other questions that the board had at the last meeting. The only thing that, the way I read it, the only thing that is not resolved are the traffic calming measures. And we have proposed traffic calming measures. Unfortunately, the town staff doesn't agree with the ones that we're proposing. But that's something that will work out. That's something between now and final. We will work out with the neighborhood, with the town. But we would, I think, if you want to say anything.
The sentiment is that Paul Driscoll, I've spoken once previously in connection with this application. We feel that the criteria for preliminary approval are more than satisfied on the existing record, and we're comfortable with that at this point. I would point out, as has been indicated by Mr. Hatem, that there will be a public hearing duly noticed as part of the final approval process that will be addressed to any of these issues. We've given an indication earlier this evening that we're prepared to meet with the residents in the neighborhood in the interim and the representatives, we will do that. There's nothing that casts this in stone this evening. It's not preliminary
subdivision approvals, not tantamount to final, and it's just a step in the process to go forward. We've been at this a long time. All of our comments, our submissions have been peer-reviewed, and I think basically there's been a lot of due process, and it's time to move forward here. Like I indicated, we will have a meeting. I'll coordinate it with Richard, and we'll set it up. But in the meantime, there will be a duly noticed public hearing as part of the regular process. So, thank you.
David.
One question.
Sure.
Comment. I'm prepared to bring a motion, but are we going to add, if we were to bring a motion, would we add the amendments now, or would that take place later?
Amendments for?
They refer to a couple of changes that you talked about, the amendments, final amendments.
You mean to the prior plans?
Each one individually.
Amending prior plans?
Yep.
I think your question is that the subdivision amendments, would right. We do those later?
Yep.
My suggestion would be that the motion that you make now keeps it all as a package.
Okay.
But there's no requirement for preliminary approval of a subdivision amendment. So the vote you take on the preliminary right now for the subdivision amendments has no weight. It's the vote you take the next time that would really formally amend the subdivisions.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Then I'll make a motion. Motion to approve finding of fact number one, Spurwink Woods LLC is requesting preliminary subdivision review and resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 42-unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Kildare Road, which requires review under Section 16-2-4 subdivision regulations and Section 19-8-3 resource protection regulations. Number two, the application was deemed complete in November 2005 and a public hearing was held December 20, 2005. Number three, the Town Council is currently considering zoning ordinance amendment that would restrict the applicability of the bisected lots provision to single-family home lots. Number four, the application substantially complies with the provisions of Section 16-3-1 subdivision regulations and Section 19-8-3 resource protection permit standards. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Spurwink Woods LLC for preliminary subdivision review and resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 42-unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Kildare Road, be approved subject to the following condition: that the extension of South Street to the common property line with the Maxwell property be deleted if the Town Council does not adopt the bisected lots amendment that makes that connection a violation of the zoning ordinance.
A motion has been made. Is there a
second?
It's been seconded. Any discussion? Barbara.
I'd like to go on record as to why I'm going to vote against the amendment, or against the
motion.
I'm voting against the motion because I feel, number one, that the subdivision's density, and I know it meets the standards of, I'm losing all my thoughts here. Help me.
Open space zoning,
thank you. That I think in light of the area and the abutters and the amount of traffic, and even though the traffic engineers have said they don't think it's too much, I can imagine how the abutters are going to feel with all the traffic going by. I think the project is too dense for the area. I think that, which is 16-1-1-E, in terms of the traffic and public safety, I think it could be viewed as a violation. I think that we are eliminating an area of enormous beauty. Most of the trees will be eliminated. Most of the 10-inch trees will be eliminated. I don't think there's anything, any getting around it. And to me, that's a violation of 16-1-1-H. I have some questions about, even though it may be legal in fact, I have questions about it being legal in intent to take a house out of an existing subdivision and turn it into an access to another subdivision. And I know that the town is very strongly in favor of connectivity, but I've searched very long and hard and I've read everything, and I do not feel I can vote in favor of preliminary approval.
Any other comments? I'd just like to make a couple of comments in response to what Barbara said, and I certainly understand her sentiments. I think we could all place ourselves in the position of a longtime resident in these two neighborhoods, and obviously you would not want to see this additional development happening right in your backyard. But as far as, is this development too dense or out of character for that existing area, I do look at a comparison between the Mitchell Highlands subdivision and Spurwink Woods. They're virtually the same in terms of acreage. Mitchell Highlands actually has 5 additional lots. It has 47 lots compared to the 42 that are proposed for Spurwink Woods. In Mitchell Highlands, there is 1 acre of open space that was preserved, therefore a lot fewer trees. In the Spurwink Woods proposal, there's 10 acres of open space, which preserves a great deal more in terms of the existing trees. And Spurwink Woods also has less roadway. All that being said, I can certainly understand if you live in Mitchell Highlands, you've grown accustomed to the beautiful surroundings. And I don't mean to sort of push that issue aside, because I know how I would feel if this were happening right by me. But I'm inclined to vote in favor of the motion, and just thought I would raise those issues for the record. I do, however, advocate that an additional condition for the motion be added, that the applicant must hold a meeting with the residents of the abutting neighborhoods prior to obtain their feedback on the traffic calming measures before we may consider this application for final subdivision approval. So I'm adding a condition.
You don't want to add the condition tonight?
Exactly.
Has it been seconded yet?
It has not been.
Okay. So how do you want that to work?
Condition. That the applicant hold a meeting with residents of the abutting neighborhoods to obtain their input regarding traffic calming measures prior to submission for final subdivision approval.
I guess it has to be minuted, or there has to be some document that comes out of that, right? Otherwise.
Right. Well, I assume what the applicant would do would send us a letter summarizing that the meeting took place, who attended, what the feedback was. There was a suggestion in the memorandum that the town staff poll the residents of Columbus Road, for example, and I think that may also be useful here. I don't know if we need to make that a condition. I don't believe we do.
I guess what I might prefer is if the applicant were to hold the meeting first and provide the full range of options for the neighborhood to think about, and then if there isn't a clear consensus that comes out of that meeting, I could have my office do the polling so we could provide you with the results of that.
So what you're saying is not putting in as an amendment here?
Yeah, you don't have to tell me, you don't have to vote to make me do it. I'll just do
okay.
It.
If David agrees with that, I'll strike it off mine too. You agree with that?
Sure.
Okay. So I won't make a change.
The change is made.
We want the meeting to occur as a condition of submission for final subdivision approval. We don't need to include a clause related to what the town staff would do.
Okay.
And I second the motion as proposed.
And I hope you mean the people on both sides.
Abutting neighborhoods.
So I would second the motion as proposed by.
Any further discussion? The amendment to the existing neighborhoods?
Yes,
he did. I believe he said he did. Okay, so we have a motion. The amendment to the motion, both have been seconded. Any further discussion? Yeah, all those in favor? All those opposed? The motion carries. Thank you.
I did. Chiefs.
Okay, that concludes the business on our agenda. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Second. Okay.
All in favor?
All those in favor? Motion to adjourn, yes. Motion carries. Thank you.